that passed.
Debates on motions with no legislative effect. Motion on implementing diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. I call upon the Honorable Starry LEE to speak and move the motion. President, I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. The reason for raising this motion is that I saw many parents are under great pressure because of their children's learning. Starting from the birth, the children have to take part in play groups, tutorial classes, prepare CVs. And the aim is to get into their kindergarten, primary school, and secondary school and university they favor. It's not just about the pressure on parents. Students are to shoulder heavy pressure as well. According to a 2014 study, the weekly learning hours is 62.2 per week. Now, the average working hour for an adult is 40 to 44 weeks, so they are learning for a longer time than our work time. According to the same James Resettlement report, taking 10 as a full mark, 33.3% of the students have a pressure rate of 7 to 10, and 14% reach 10 score marks. So 1 in 7 students are experiencing extremely heavy pressure. And there are news reports saying that students commit suicide because of their burden. It's very saddening. As a parent, I think it's difficult to change the overall culture in Hong Kong. So parents have to be following the usual practices in the community, so they try their best to provide the best education to their children. And some have chosen to be a tiger mom, and they would like to prepare the best CV for their children to provide the best education that they think that's the best for their children. And some middle-class parents, some elites in the society, would like to pay a higher fee to get their children into international schools. They don't want to be tiger parents. They want their children to learn in a happy way, and some believe that overseas education may work best for their children for their future. So we see that many more middle-class parents who can afford the means to send their children to international schools or to studying IBs. So we have been discussing here that the number of IB places are not enough, and that's because parents, a lot more parents, are opting for international schools. Now, for those students who are in traditional schools, in the junior, the children, well, the parents may send their children to boarding schools when they for study in junior and secondary, senior secondary curriculum. Now, many legislators here. You are financially sound, and I believe that your friends may have opted for that route as well. Now, students and parents under a heavy pressure. As a legislator, I've often think to myself, what can we do? Is this the case that our system is sick and there are problems and leading to such heavy pressure on parents and students? And so many middle-class parents have opted for alternative curriculum for their children. So I'm moving this motion to gauge the collective wisdom, hoping that you can suggest ways to help our parents and children. So I have six specific points in my motion. First, I would like to give parents, those from the middle class and grassroots, to more choices. So I'm asking that the government should introduce a suitable proportion of international curriculum in subsidized schools to provide more choices to parents. Second, to tie in the needs of the modern community, this is an age of AI. So I think the STEM education is not adequate at present, and we can do better. So we must allocate more resources to schools for training teachers to support schools in promoting STEM education and other arts and AI courses. Third, from my observation, one of the pressure of students comes from the DSE's exam model. Now, it's a tick or die type of education, and the curriculum is very heavy. A lot of students can't cope with it, and many of the exam papers are very difficult. Especially for the Chinese subject, it's difficult to get very good grades. Well, this is called, the most difficult subject for students, and liberal studies has been criticized by legislators all along. This is a compulsory subject, and the curriculum is very heavy, and a lot of students have to take it because it is a compulsory subject. So as a result, they can't take other more elective courses. So can LS be made an elective subject instead of a compulsory subject? I think that can help lessen the burden on students. And fourth, increasing the number of subsidized university places and subsidized top-up places in universities. When I moved my first motion in the LeshGo, I also asked for this. This is a bottleneck. Over the years, we have only 15,000 places. So overall, 20% of the secondary school leavers can enroll in universities. So the quota is very limited. So everyone wants to get in. So that's why we are seeing drilling in primary schools and secondary schools so that students would like to get into a university. If that bottleneck is not eased, then the pressure on students will not be eased. Fifth, we should increase the opportunities for students to participate in mainland and overseas exchange programs. This has been done in the past, and I think we should keep that up. We hope that students can broaden their international horizon. They can get experience in the mainland as well. Sixth, we should enhance parental education. According to my observation, it's mostly NGOs which are doing this in the community. There is no systematic parent education. The parents will try to share their feelings and experience through WhatsApp group. Some parents find that they think they are okay, but under such great pressure, there is indeed a need for us to get government subsidy to enhance parent education so that parents know how to help their children and ease the pressure on themselves and their children. Now, I would like to focus on point one, because there have been criticisms on that area, and the legislator in the sector has written a letter to the government. My motion is that we should introduce a suitable proportion of international curriculum so as to give parents and students more choices, especially for the grassroots parents. They should be given more choices. Recently, the Heritage Foundation of the US has ranked Hong Kong as the freest economy for 25 years in a row. We have a lot of freedom in the flow of goods, information, capital, etc. And such freedom has given us a lot of opportunities to develop economically. But what's ironical is that if we're talking about a subsidized school sector, there is only one model of teaching. And all students have to take DSE. So this is a very much a monopoly market. Parents and students don't have a choice. I must say that there are some merits in the education system and DSE system. With the hard efforts of our educators, the system has nurtured some very good students in Hong Kong, and many very good schools are welcomed by parents. But the greatest problem is this is just a single model and is not fit for all students. The system has nurtured excellent students for us, but at the same time, there are a lot of students who fail, and children who have lost their self-confidence because they have performed poorly in examinations. So we should have different systems for catering to the needs of different people. I'm not saying that the system is perfect. Of course, there is room for improvement. But we should not just have a single model, a single choice. And there is only one curriculum for subsidized schools. And we are not giving parents and students more choices. Indeed, many students who have opted for international curriculum, whether it's in the kindergarten stage and primary stage, they may not actually perform be very well. But then when they go overseas to study, they have become somebody else. They have enhanced their self-confidence. So how come that only parents with economic means can have their students achieving that? It's just that the middle class and grassroots parents don't have a choice. If you look at UK, well, many legislators would like to send their children to the UK, and that is not the schools there are not having a single model. They just A-level, GCSE, and IB courses, and some schools are providing foundation courses as well. So children, based on their own actual circumstances, can opt for different curriculum exam models, which can enable them to get into university. I believe that we should give parents and students more choices and ease their pressure. So, President, the first point in my motion is about breaking out of the straitjacket in that there is only one type of curriculum in subsidized schools. I would like to give more choices to middle-class parents. Now, as to exactly how it should be implemented, when, at what grade it should start, this is subject for discussion. Even if my proposal is supported by the community, ultimately, only a small number of students can get into the international curriculum. The majority will still have to study in the traditional system or curriculum. So, Mr. Yip, you said that the point one in my motion will make it difficult for students to learn about Chinese culture and history. I don't think that's true, and you don't have to be excessively worried. If we or agree that a bit more international curriculum can be introduced into the subsidized system, then that would be good. Since it's a subsidized schools, we can always still have Chinese culture courses. Don't get worried about that. So I hope to highlight this point, and I would like to listen to members' response on that. Now, I must also emphasize and clarify here, it's point number four. Increasing the numbers of subsidized university places and subsidized top-up places for the second year in universities. I would like to thank Mr. Yip Kin-yuen for pointing out this. Well, a more accurate description is increasing the numbers of subsidized university places and subsidized articulation places. Now, as more, there are more sub-degree holders, they should be able to get into the second and third year of university study. So I would like to put on record that it should be changed into increasing the numbers of subsidized university places and subsidized articulation places or top-up places in universities. Just so that's all I want to say. So I'll be all ears to other members' views.
I now propose to question you that the motion moved by the Honorable Starry be passed. 8 members will move amendments to this motion. This council will conduct a joint debate on the motion and the amendments. I will now call upon members who will move the amendments to speak in the following order: the Honorable Claudia Mo, the Honorable Yip Kin-yuen, the Honorable Peter Charles Mok, the Honorable Ho Kai-ming, the Honorable Ho Chi-fung, Dr. Fernando Zhang, Honorable Xiu Ka-chun, and Ms. Tanya Chen. They may not move amendments at this stage. Ms. Claudia Mo. Really, do I agree with Ms. Starry LEE on a number of issues? But she said that we should introduce international curriculums into our subsidized schools in a suitable proportion. And I think I agree with her. We should not confine our students to only local curriculum. Now, take IB International Baccalaureate as an example. It is well recognized secondary curriculum for admission to universities, and the grades can be recognized by all universities over the world in admission of students. Well, you may say that IB may not be too relevant to local students. I beg to differ. Now, for students I know who take IB, now one has done a topic on the history of prayers among Chinese people. Another topic is the origin and downfall, the rise and fall of Kowloon Walled City. I think that is very meaningful. Although it is called IB, it doesn't conflict with our local culture. Why must students take DSE in Hong Kong? As we all know, overdrilling of students is a problem in Hong Kong, mainly in Chinese, English, and mathematics. For myself, mathematics is a nightmare to me, and if we learn by rote learning, someone originally faces north and he has turned three times towards the south, and then finally what is the direction he faces. Now students are rather confused. And as for Chinese and English, I think the situation has become more and more unacceptable, including our Chinese curriculum. The Chinese language you use here now is more and more stilted. I must criticize the Secretary for Education. He answered an oral question here, and he used the Chinese term yaofa, meaning enhance, a number of times. Why couldn't he just say "改善," which means improvement or enhancement? Why must he use a language of the Chinese Communist Party? He is actually murdering the Chinese language, though he is the Secretary for Education. But of course, we have a pro-establishment members here in this council. I talk about 予以支持, 予以肯定, meaning giving something his support, his recognition. Well, why should we turn verbs into nouns? This is because that is the common way the Chinese language has been used in communist China. So in Hong Kong, children are not interested in learning the Chinese subject as well. Well, when you come to apply for that $400, one question is about elaborate on your economic activity status. And in fact, the question is asking you to state whether you're a housewife, a student, so on and so forth. And actually, that is just an optional question. So the Chinese standard in Hong Kong has been dragged down by government officials. Now, the main point in my amendment is to improve English language education. And in Chinese, I use the word improve, to 要改善. Of course, I'm sure in his reply, the secretary would talk about 予以提升, putting a noun, another verb in front of verb which has been turned into a noun. So When we teach the Chinese language, we talked about this being a transitive verb or intransitive verb. Why should we learn the Chinese language in this way? Now, English, we are learning a foreign language, and you teach students whether this is a transitive or intransitive verb. Students don't know what you're talking about, and I think we are killing kids' interest in learning English. In fact, if they can learn English well, that will help them to broaden their horizon. Whether you're in the Netherlands or in Japan, well, people will not ask you whether you can speak Dutch or Japanese respectively. They will only ask you, do you speak English? However, learning English well is a great pressure for students. Kids think that it is a nightmare. I once heard from a P4 and another occasion, and S2 student, that what they fear most is the English language. So teachers have no choice but to follow the syllabus given to them. And I've heard people telling students that it is fun to learn English. It is a language we can use every day. So you do not make fun of others if for their poor pronunciation or wrong grammar. Now, if you ridicule another student, then you may fear that people will also make fun of your English, and you would refrain from using English. So in Hong Kong, we start learning English at 2 and all the way to university. People are worried about learning English, and nobody likes to use English. And therefore, even some professionals have a very horrifying English, like vexatious. What is vexatious? In fact, he meant vexatious. And he called somebody frivolous. What is frivolous? In fact, he meant frivolous. So this is a laughing stock. Now, this is a lawmaking body. How can we teach the next generation well? Now, if students use that scene to teach, or that footage to teach students, then I think students will remember till they die what is vexatious and frivolous. And I once mentioned this word sulk to an associate lecturer in university. S-U-L-K, sulk, is not really a very difficult word. Sulk, meaning you're sulky, or you're sulking. But we don't teach students such a word. We're teaching students very dated English from Shakespeare and Chaucer. And as a result, students cannot communicate with others using the English they've learned. Kids now are asked to listen to National Geographic, and they are taught vocabulary items like panoramic, golden trough. What is a Panamanian? And people don't even know where Panama is. And I think we are forcing such hard vocabulary on students. This is all because of a competitive mindset. Parents think that if their kids can get into an English media school, that's the best. And if you can afford it, go to DSS school. And then if you are even more well off, you can send your kids to a boarding school overseas, thinking that if you have money, you can create a brighter future for your students. And what kind of an education environment we have? It has totally collapsed.
Mr.
Kin-yuen,
Thank you, Mr. President. I thank Ms. Starry LEE for moving this motion titled Implementing Diversified Education to Alleviate the Pressure on Students and Parents. This is really a very daunting problem facing the education sector in Hong Kong. Well, a few days ago, I received some visitors, and they asked about the problem in our education sector. And I explained that, in fact, we have great achievements in a lot of education competitions around the world. And in fact, Finland's education system is also very good. But what are we sacrificing ourselves for such achievements? Many students nowadays are mentally unwell. They need to seek medical help. They face a lot of pressure, so as teachers. So when there is so much we have paid for in our system, we really should review the situation. I agree with Ms. Starry LEE, but one major difference is this. I earlier wrote to members about the introduction of international curriculum in aided schools. Well, my specialty is comparative education, and I looked at the education systems around the world. So I also got an understanding in international curriculum. Now, if we look at the curriculum of a particular country, we need to look at the objective. For example, the objective of one government may be the five domains of education. It may be a sense of civic duty, and that is how we could cultivate students to have global vision whilst cultivating a sense of belonging of the place. One important function of education is to have consensus in society. In our generation, we may be able to talk about what we have learned in our textbook because we share the same curriculum. We could even cite some paragraphs in the same classical Chinese article. And it is important to have this kind of consensus. So I have never seen any country introducing the curriculum of another country in the public funded schools in the country. Now, Ms. Starry LEE just now mentioned that in UK, they also have schools running IB curriculum. I believe this should be a private school. Because for IB, I understand the funding comes from a separate source. I don't think this is a public school in the UK. In fact, several months ago, I talked to the education officials in the UK when I was visiting the UK, and indeed there are students taking the IB courses and taking the IB exam on their own, but this is not the common scenario in schools. So we need to understand that education plays a social function in any country, and at the same time, I also agree with Ms. Starry LEE, because she was asking why many parents prefer international schools. Now, be it government officials or members of this council, I think we should face this issue squarely, because indeed many local people are criticizing local schools quite harshly. They have strong views on our schools. So as the title of this motion suggests, it is hoped that to alleviate the pressure on students, these parents would very often opt for international schools, or they may even emigrate. Of course, there are other factors, political and other deep-seated factors. Setting them aside, education is still a problem for us. Now, we have other problems such as over-drilling and English proficiency. We need to take a proactive approach. That's for our local schools. Well, I think the education sector is responsible for reviewing our system. If we place the focus on international schools today, however, we'll be missing the opportunity to improve our local curriculum. We will be making less effort in improving local curriculum. In fact, many government officials have sent their children to international schools or to study abroad. When it comes to local education system, they do not practice what they preach. There is no primary three TSA in international schools. So whilst they send children overseas, at the same time, they introduce TSA in primary schools. Now, if this is what you aspire, why can't you implement the same practice across the territory? I don't want to comment on any on personal choices, but if this is really your choice, I hope that government officials could also meet the aspirations of the public in general. So I hope that we will not be distracted by the issue of international schools, because this is an issue we have to deal with. For international curriculum, I understand that there will be fewer or less emphasis on local culture and local history. Say if it's a Japanese school, of course they would teach about the history and culture of Japan. In fact, recently I was asked whether the national anthem would be taught in the international schools, because this is not their mission, and they would, of course, have grave doubts about this. In fact, on the mainland, there are also criticisms about the setting up of international schools. Well, let's set politics aside. I think what we should do is to draw on the reference of international schools and international curriculum to improve our own curriculum and education. So about the curriculum reform that is underway, I do have high hopes. I hope that the reform can meet proposals and suggestions mentioned in members' motion and amendments, because the pressure starts from primary school. We have the P3 TSA, and the drills just go on and on. And just now, Ms. Starry LEE referred to diversified education. I'm all for that, but I think that apart from academic pursuits, there should be other curricula available to students. About a decade ago, I was the principal of a school. I asked the Education Bureau whether it was possible to not require students to take the DSE exam, whether any other form of recognition is possible, not in the form of academic pursuits. In Germany, in Switzerland, Scandinavian countries, this is exactly what they're doing. Apart from academic exams, students can take other forms of examination, and that is practical, vocational education examinations. So can we introduce different courses and different forms of examinations at the secondary school stage so as to provide multiple pathways for our students? I think we should consider all these suggestions. Recently, we talked about the SHINE case. We'd like to have different schools tailored for different students' needs. So I think this would be great. Thank you.
Mr. Charles Mok. I'd like to thank Ms. Starry LEE for moving the motion on implementing diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. Education is empirical to us and our future generation, as well as the competitiveness of Hong Kong. The Lausanne School published the talent report last year. Some countries like Singapore has surpassed Hong Kong to become top of Asia, while Hong Kong's ranking dropped from 12th to 18th. And in terms of manpower readiness and other aspects, the rankings declined. And the 2019 Global Manpower Competitiveness Index was published, and Hong Kong ranked behind places like Taiwan and Tokyo. And this shows that there are urgent issues in education and manpower that we need to address. And of course, there are many reasons for such decline. We have a lot of people engaging in startups, but the quantity and quality are still lacking. And these led to a decline in our rankings. In my sector, there is a lack of technology talent. And these have been obstacles that stand in the way of further development of our INT sector. In terms of STEM education, the curriculum should be reformed. We have been talking about these for years. I'd like to talk about foundation education and how we can enhance the digital readiness of our young generation. The government said that STEM education is not a new or independent subject, and STEM has been incorporated into the primary and secondary school curricula. There are no assessments or exams, so have the curricula been effective? With the advancement of technology, are we providing enough teaching support? When the EDB promotes STEM, very often they are treated as extracurricular activities, and the readiness and the readiness of certain students might be enhanced, but this cannot alleviate our manpower shortage. In the as you know, Hong Kong students score very high in the international PISA exams, but we are not producing any mathematicians. Many less and less students are learning advanced mathematics in DSE. Professors have told us that for students taking up science or engineering disciplines in the university, their foundation in math and science have been weak, and they must take foundation classes. Among the four compulsory subjects, only math is a science subject, and this has led to a decline in the proficiency of science and math for senior secondary school students. And in recent years, we see that in the past, many science students took up physics, chemistry, and biology, and nowadays it's no longer the case, which is shocking. And this is the biggest problem with the DSE system. The report also pointed out that in US, Europe, Korea, etc., science has been made compulsory, but in Hong Kong, STEM education is not prevalent, and the enrollment rate in advanced mathematics is only at 14%, which is far lower than the 57 to 80% in Korea and Taiwan. So the interest in math and science is lower than that on business subjects. When we look at 2018 figures, there were only 5,567 enrolling in the information technology subject. But this is not the focus today. We should enhance our STEM education before we can enhance our talent. For UK and US, etc., STEM is treated as a key project for the nation. And last month, the US published their plans to promote STEM education in the next 5 years. Part of the plan is to prepare the STEM workforce for the future. They have very clear objectives. They have a 100K in 10, and that is by 2020, 100,000 STEM teachers would be trained up. And they have a US 2020 vision, and that is to conduct matching, to match students with tutors so that they can pick up STEM knowledge. The UK government is also investing heavily, and last year they invested £64 million to train up IT teachers, and £76 million were invested to support a startup which would train up 40,000 IT teachers. So you can see that they have the objectives, they have the KPIs and the strategies. But as you know, the Hong Kong government does not like to set indicators for themselves. And in terms of teaching support and measures, for the integrated teaching subsidy on IT from 2019 to 20 for public schools and DSS schools, $900 million worth of grants would be allocated. But is this the end of the problem? The EDB spends a few hundred million dollars on the fourth IT plan, and the audit criticized that management was subpar. There was no monitoring on the effectiveness, and support to schools were lacking. And the audit found that more than half the schools did not exhaust the grants, and more than 15% never used a grant, or they never used more than 20% of the grant. Many schools complain that there are not enough resources for e-learning, but the reality is that some schools have too much funds while others have too little. And there's an imbalance in resources, so the EDB should reconsider their policy and strategy and draw up realistic indicators or targets for themselves. And there's also a lack of support for grassroots children. The after the internet learning scheme ended in August last year, for schools with their own devices, a subsidy would be given to schools to purchase such equipment. Many schools are not participating in this program, and this is still a very big issue. And in my amendment, I propose setting up an education technology lab. And the idea is similar to a smart city lab. Many schools have the funds, but they don't know how to use them. So we need an environment for them to learn about the technology available in the market. So hopefully the smart city element can be injected into education in the future smart city plan. I hope the government would do more to alleviate the burden on parents and students. As for the issue of PSA, when we discussed this with the secretary yesterday, we see that the government refused to open up a lot of data, and this would not be conducive to easing the burden on parents and students. And in line with the open data policy, the government should publish all these data to the public. Thank you.
Mr. Jonathan Ho. Thank you, President. President, worldwide, well, nobody can claim that they are expert in subjects. Well, there are only two subjects whereby people can claim themselves as experts, philosophy and education. Education is a profession in itself, but it is not that easy to be an expert. I have completed the education diploma program, but I didn't join the teaching sector. I found that teacher is a more difficult job than a legislator. A teacher has to memorize the names of 200 students. A legislator doesn't have to do that. So how should we be providing professional education? And we should be devoting more resources for the teachers. I have 12 points in my amendments. I will focus on talking about two of them. One is about diversified education. And then it's about support to parents. I think diversified education is important. Yesterday, we met with the principals' associations in 5 to 6 districts. They have a certain views on the agenda items in our education panel. When I studied for education, they told me this, and that was also mentioned yesterday. It's not about providing the top-notch classes to the students. Not every student is a student in a band one school. So not every student is fit to study in an international school or band one school. So the gist is to provide the appropriate education to students. But how should we do that? That is the most important thing. Way back when I studied for education, the teachers taught me that when we designed the curriculum, don't think that the students will take in everything you teach them. We have to measure how much the students can take in before we come up with the design of the curriculum. We talk about diversified education. If we want to implement that, we should have multiple pathways for the students so that the students can choose among different types of professions. After the 90s, we didn't see that happening. Secretary, many industrial colleges and vocational colleges have been phased out. Students are only left with one pathway, and that is they should study only in the grammar schools. And this is a mainstream approach. But then, in fact, we are forcing the students who are not fit for grammar schools to still teach in the grammar schools and do poorly. Now, I met with a parent, and my son was criticized by the teachers, and my son was claimed to be very restless, and special care had to be provided to him. Now, in the class, there may be students who are very obedient, but there are bound to be a few, including my son, who is restless. And then my son has very has good focus, and he likes to listen to storytelling. But in our system, do we provide the appropriate pathways for our students, provide the appropriate approaches for students so that they can opt for the best way for themselves? In the actual operation of the schools, maybe we have to divide the students into different groups. Teachers may not want to do that, but they are forced to do so. So students are finding it more difficult to explore their potential to the fullest. We talk about promoting STEM. We want to broaden the horizon of students, and students should not be just learning, say, the traditional subjects like Chinese, English, but can really schools offer those courses? We don't even manage to offer Chinese history, not to mention about these other STEM courses. Now, in the past decade, we talk about integrated education. Theoretically, this is something right, but in actual implementation, it's difficult to implement. You are mixing two groups of students, the obedient ones with those not so obedient in the same class. So that makes it more difficult for the teachers to teach. And the gap among the two groups is also widened. Earlier, we talked about the issue of lab techs, and many lab technicians told us that it's difficult to teach about experiments in labs. If there are some active students in the class, you have to deal with their discipline all the time, so you can't really focus on the experiments on hand because you are spending so much time to take care and uphold the safety of these active students. In my in point 8 of my amendment, I suggest that when the qualification framework is being refined, is it possible for us to provide students who are more fit for vocational education to have professional and vocational training? Many technicians don't graduate from grammar schools. They may be graduating, may have graduated from vocational colleges. So we need diversified education. And then there is also the importance of parental education. I grew up in the 80s. Many parents spend a lot of time working. And nowadays, many parents are full-time parents. But how come the problem has worsened? My parents spent more time working. They didn't have too much time for us. My mom took care of myself and my younger brother full-time, but still she had to take on some part-time work from a textile factory. But how come that when parents are spending more time with their children, we are also seeing the worsening of the problem? Do we provide choices for the parents, to provide choices to the students? This is very important. So we really now count on the schools to teach the parents, to teach their students or their children. Now, my son studies in the N class, and I have to attend a number of activities and other seminars and so on. We ask the parents to go through the same experience as the students, but shouldn't the parents be working on their own sometimes to teach their students, like, say, taking them to take a ride on the ferry? Should the schools be providing more after-school services to care for the students so that the parents can work full-time and then spend their time during the holidays with their children? Should more choices be given to the parents? So should kindergartens be providing more childcare services? I think this is also very important. Parents should be given the choice to work full-time as well. I think we are lacking such choices in Hong Kong, that is to allow the parents to choose the way they want to teach their children. So the last point that I would like to make is on point 12, is about enhancing counseling services. SGT and social workers are the issues. So in the upcoming budget, I hope that there will be more resources devoted so that there should be more guidance teachers to work together alongside the social workers in the schools. So there is indeed a need for manpower resources to deal with special cases. So please think about whether 1+1 is feasible so that better services can be provided to the students.
Mr. Ted Hui. Thank you, Madam Deputy. This debate gives us an opportunity to discuss the fundamental problems in our education sector. And that is, we are still adhering to elitism and we have an exam-oriented system. We only have eyes on the exam scores. This is a deep-rooted concept. Just now, Ms. Starry LEE mentioned that for parents who are better off, they would opt for international schools. Indeed, this is how many parents feel. And I agree, as a parent, that if I have money, I should go for international school as well. In the minds of many parents, it has nothing to do with whether international curriculum is better or not. Rather, they would like to give less pressure to their children so that their children won't spend all their time drilling, studying for examinations. This is in fact what parents have been telling me, even parents who are professionals. Well, they would like just to take the pressure off their shoulders. If money is the answer, they would rather pay more to resolve the problem. This is in fact the wish of parents across the social strata. So, Secretary, I believe you must have heard this suggestion that we should enact legislation to prevent children of government officials from studying abroad. Of course, this is a radical idea, but I think, Secretary, you understand what it implies. Because whilst your children are studying abroad, my children are studying in local schools. Parents want the children to study in international schools because the pressure is less. And for the Samaritan Hotline, they conducted a poll, and out of 124 secondary school students, over 80% of them believe that the major source of pressure is academic work. And also for the Hong Kong Baptist Church Social Service Center, Oi Kwan Service Center, there was another poll, and 51.5% of students exhibit different degrees of signs of depression. And for the same service unit, there was another poll of P3 to P6 students, over 1,000 of them, 21.2% of them agreed that they feel they're under pressure all the time. Of course, it has to do with little free time, their choice of secondary school, and too much homework. I think this is also the sentiment of many parents. The majority of local students and parents agree that schoolwork is putting too much pressure on them and they are close to breakdown. Of course, I agree that we should have diversified education, and we all understand, as the saying goes, that we should opt for true learning and not going after examination scores. We understand the need to train people to think outside the box, but every day, after-school students will still need to attend the tuition classes. They have a lot of homework. And how Therefore, can we help them think outside the box? And in fact, they are trained inside the box, rather. So in my amendment, I mentioned that the government should look into the pressure put on by too much schoolwork on students, and there should be a policy of finishing homework at school to enable students to develop diverse interests in their spare time. There should be spare time for children to play. Apparently, small children should not only focus on doing homework. And according to many parents, they think that schoolwork is getting harder and harder. And in fact, the meaning of homework has changed. For P3 homework nowadays, P1 students will start doing this homework. How would a small child understand something that is really beyond their reach, something that should only be taught taught years later? Let me share with you another story. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to pick up my child from school, and my child says, "Well, guess what? Do I need to do homework after school today?" "No, because I finish homework at school already." "That's great. Well, my daughter is studying P1, and imagine, it's really a great joy for her to finish schoolwork homework at school, so that when my child goes home, there would be spare time for her to have time, spend time with parents, to play, to read storybooks. And this is very important, and it is very good to implement this policy for the benefit of parents and students. Next point, over-drilling for examination. This is a long-standing problem. We're all aware of it. Of course, we have been discussing the same issue at panel meetings and here, that there should not be over-drilling. And the Education Bureau always pays lip service, agreeing that this is not a good culture. And that is why I have put in my amendment that there should be a policy. Every year, when you assess the performance of schools, can you amend the indicators to require that assessment be done to see if schools are over-drilling their students? Because we only gauge the results of homework. We do not assess whether the homework is too much. We should include this as an indicator to assess the performance of schools. Well, I think the government cannot shun this responsibility of maintaining the TSA. It has been criticized for many years, and despite all the objections, schools continue to have TSAs, albeit we have sampling and anonymous assessment. And yesterday, we tried to ask for the number of schools involved in the TSAs. You refused to give us the figures. We are antagonized because you are still encouraging schools to compete with each other for the sake of branding and encouraging competition among students. Now, about P3 TSA, I think that it should be scrapped altogether. Students should not be put under this pressure of over-drilling. If you cannot control schools in over-drilling the students, you should control the schools directly, Secretary. So when it comes to diversified education, we must consider whether our education is getting homogeneous. For international schools, well, you may ask them to learn the national anthem as well. Is it homogeneous or not? Well, you should give an option to schools. You should not mandate the TSA, because otherwise, how will we have diversified education? You need to reflect on yourself, Secretary.
Dr. Fernando Zhang, Madam Deputy, I thank you for moving this motion on implementing diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. In the subcommittee on children's rights, we had a meeting dedicated to the issue of children's rights under schoolwork and examination pressure. Children in Hong Kong are very fortunate. We are a relatively well-off society. They have they're well provided for. We have good school campuses and teachers. So in an advanced economy like Hong Kong, with good physical environment and with substantial investment in education, our students are supposed to be happy and have the opportunity to give full play to the potential. Unfortunately, the children in Hong Kong are always rather unhappy. A director has produced a movie on difficulties faced by students, and he wanted to make a short. It was on the 1st of September. He wanted to capture the joy on the faces of students. His crew spent the whole day going to different schools trying to capture happy faces of students. But at the end of the day, he couldn't even find one successful shot because he could not capture happy faces of students going to school. So what has gone wrong? And in our public hearing, it was revealed that what children lacked most in Hong Kong was the time to sleep and to play. The majority of the time is spent on so-called learning. But do they enjoy learning? Are they really learning? They are just mechanically following what is given to them by adults. They spend their whole day in schools already, and in classrooms a lot has been arranged for them, and at weekends homework is assigned to them so that their weekend can be more fruitful. And then parents also have extracurricular activities for them at weekends, not to mention they're going to tutorials after school and at weekends. Our students are just exhausted. They are really exhausted. 2 decades back, when I first returned to Hong Kong, my eldest child just finished P1 in the US. And when we came back, the first thing I did was to enroll him in a mainstream school in Hong Kong. He or she was new to Hong Kong. He's not used to the language spoken here. However, luckily, the teachers and the school were very caring. And although it was mainstream school, the problems were not obvious. However, drilling started when he reached P4, and we had to help him finish his homework every evening. By P5, he got rather tense, and he was short-tempered, and every evening it was either myself or my wife struggling with him. Perhaps all families in Hong Kong would have similar experience if their students are attending a local school. So there is usually a big pile of homework waiting to be finished. We want to force them to speed up, but of course we can't do the homework for him. And by P5, he got rather tense, and he had to use the bathroom very frequently. And we felt that something was wrong, and if it were to go on like that way, we were worried that he would suffer both physically and mentally. So by then, we thought of any other alternative. So when he was about to attend P6, we put him in an ESL school. That was not our intention. We moved back thinking that he could acquire proficiency in the Chinese language and can and could attend a normal local school. But we could not go on in that way. Luckily, I was a lecturer in the university. I could afford an ESL school, ESF school, an English school foundation school. And back then, school fees were not that expensive. So a few years afterwards, our relationship and family improved, and then he was happier. How come we've spent so much money in education and with so many experts, and yet the so-called education we offer is so depressing for our students? I think it is time for us to reflect. I think the problem doesn't lie with our children, but with the education system and the adults. Why must we pressurize our students in schools? I said, as you said, Deputy Chairman. It's common sense that nowadays our children have to complete university education. Otherwise, how are they supposed to make a living? So I think it is the expectation of almost all parents that our children can attend tertiary education. Perhaps that's not the expectation of our children. And we've held on to the threshold of 16% or 18%, but because of a decline in student population, we finally reached 20% of the cohort receiving subsidized tertiary education. And the administration has created associate degrees and post-secondary diploma. But as we all know, it is like the great leap forward in education. Some of the programs are now closed because they could not have sufficient student intake. You know, you have to spend more than $200,000 in per year for a degree place. And for medical and professional programs, the cost per capita is even higher. So were they willing to invest or put resources into tertiary education will determine how many students can receive subsidized tertiary education. Every year, we're just adding a few hundred new places, and we have adhered to the percentage of 18 or 16%. Now, we should provide fully subsidized tertiary education places for all students who are willing, who are eligible to be enrolled. Like in many European countries, they offer free tertiary education for all students. What's wrong with that? Is it a sin to offer free subsidized tertiary education? Now, because of the cap on the number of students that can have subsidized tertiary education, there is a trickling down effect, and from secondary, primary to kindergarten, students are forced to enter elite schools so that they can attend tertiary education. Now, for maximum working hours, well, Mr. Shogajan passed a motion in the subcommittee I chaired. Well, internationally, there is a standard for maximum homework hours. P1, 10 minutes. P2, 20 minutes. And at grade 12, you should at most spend 2 hours in homework after school. And of course, the quality, it is the quality that counts. Homework should not focus on drilling. And we should make sure that homework is helpful to consolidate their learning. Well, you pay lip service to saying no to rote learning. How come our education system is doing exactly the opposite? Thank you.
Mr. Xiu Ka-chun. Thank you, Madam Deputy, for the motion moved by yourself. It is to implement diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. I agree with the crux of the original motion, and I have added 2 items under my amendment motion. And educationists might know about a book called How Children Learn to Fail. It was written by John Hawke in 1964. And he found that for people or students who show vitality after they are immersed in a school environment, they might lose that vitality. And the reason is that the students might be afraid to fail, and as such, their imagination is stifled because they are afraid to fail. And the framework of subjects have limited the imagination of students, and the students are unable to realize their ideas, and that's why they feel bored. And Hong Kong's education system is very similar to what John Hawke said. And there was a lack of training in certain skills for the new century curriculum. The idea is to build a diversified curriculum, but apart from the 4 compulsory subjects, students can only pick 4 more subjects from out of 21. And the 21 subjects are mostly traditional subjects, and there are 3 applied learning subjects. The recognition is very low, and as such, student numbers remain very low, and there is a lack of university places, and university training is career-oriented. So how can we facilitate diversified and happy learning? A few academics said that in terms of the DSE, the applied learning results should be considered for university admission, and the recognition of applied learning subjects should not be less than that of DSE. And through the results, teachers can know about the capability of the students, and the applied learning subjects can offer different learning opportunities and broaden the students' horizons. The government should consider providing diversified learning opportunities beyond the mainstream framework. And the heavy burden faced by students is stifling. Students cannot even take care of their own well-being. And to tackle this, apart from allocating more resources, we must believe that less means more. Through policies, you should unleash the learning potential of students so that they can understand the idea of learning. And that's why I propose a school retreat day and homework free days. Holidays are supposed to be a time to relax for students, but for primary and secondary school students, on long holidays, they have to do a lot of homework, and some even have to take extra lessons in school. 58% of the teenagers sleep less than the recommended duration, and the happiness index for Hong Kong students is only 6.5 percent, which is 11% lower than other places. If they cannot take a break during long holidays, how can they deal with the stress? The Hong Kong Christian Service conducted a study with the Faculty of Education of SHIU in terms of learning happiness. Students with less homework were found to be much happier, and they have a better motivation to learn, and they reacted more positively to homework. We are not negating the value of homework, but we want to say that allowing students to do homework on their own terms would be much more effective. And on holidays, students should relax or even indulge themselves so that they can prepare for the challenges ahead or develop their hobbies. They can simply relax. Everything should be centered around the students. We should not ask them to do a lot of homework on their holidays. For NGOs such as the Lutheran Service, according to a study, for every 7 primary school students, 1 is depressed, and 19% are seriously depressed, and the main source of stress is homework. The EDB's main task should be to maintain the motivation to learn for students so that they can remain curious as they learn, or else knowledge acquired would become meaningless. The knowledge should be internalized by the students if they are to be effective. If you offer very difficult knowledge or too much of them, it would not be beneficial. Less homework should be assigned for long holidays, and the government should step one step higher by establishing homework free days, by learning from other places or other NGOs. In terms of a school retreat day, the idea is to provide some respite or a break for students. Students and teachers are both very busy, so we should assign a day for them to have a break and retreat. And the idea of a retreat day is to prepare them better for the challenges ahead. Hong Kong's education system brings a lot of stress to students, and there is a lot of competition, and such culture begins from primary school. Parents, teachers, and students are constantly under stress, and a school retreat day might not be a fundamental solution, but it sends a very clear message that some students, parents, and teachers all need a break. In the past 2 years, a number of NGOs have helped set up school retreat days for various schools in Hong Kong, and they were much welcomed by parents, students, and teachers, and the EDB recognizes the value of such a retreat. But there's a lack of actual support from the government. According to the EDB's requirements, there are 190 school days, of which 165 must be actual school days, while the rest are for exams, sports days, or non-lesson days. If a school retreat day is treated like an extracurricular activity, some schools might decide against designated a day, citing time reasons, or some schools might arrange extra lessons to make up for the time loss. So this is putting the cart before the horse, and it would not achieve the objective. And with a school retreat day, everyone can take a break to prepare further ahead. Other members have been talking about their children. I want to talk about my nephew called Xiu Yong, and in Chinese, it sounds the same as smile. And today I'd like to put a smile on my nephew. Thank you.
Chen Shuzhong議員.
Ms. Tanya Chen, Madam Deputy, some people said that how much the government treasures its people depends on the resources the government spends on sectors which do not generate return, for example, healthcare, elderly, social welfare. It's easy to devote resources to a sector which yields return. Sometimes Washington Central Link is an exception. For projects which do not yield a return, it is difficult to take forward those. And this is something the government wants to evade all the time. Under Carrie Lam's governance, Hong Kong has become a very tragic city. The elderly have been begging the government, and it's only that the government has made a decision to withdraw the $200 deduction arrangement for the elderly. And for the frontline healthcare staff, they are in deep light and they've begged you, and then you give them $500 million. But that doesn't solve the problem. And the high-ranking officials are silly. They took group photos, and the doctors were asked to take national courses. And in Hong Kong, the education system is no better. Well, the recurrent expenditure on education is 25% in the reunification, and in 2019 it's just 20%, and it took up only 3.3% of the GDP last year. If you look at the figures, 3.3% is quite good, but according to the United Nations figures, 3.3% is much lower than that in the high human development country and very high development country. And that is talking about 4.6 to 5.5%. Even for low human development countries, the average is 3.8%, and we're still lagging behind. Of course, the government can continue to delude itself. I've got a paper on the website on Asian capitals. The Asian an article on Asian education hubs, it says that Hong Kong lacks natural resources, but the good quality of education in Hong Kong gives a good opportunity for Hong Kong people to get. And the Hong Kong government continue to feel that it's good, and it turns a blind eye to the problems in education system. Parents and teachers have been oppressed by the education system. It can still sing praises of its own education system. But that doesn't mean that the problems have gone away. Ms. Starry LEE moved this motion and gives us an opportunity to speak on behalf of the teachers and parents. Now, of course, I understand the secretary. While he was promoted from undersecretary to the secretary, he has been in touch with school representatives and parents and teachers. And I hope that you can have a humble mind all the time and listen to people's views. Education can help people get out of poverty and move upward socially. On behalf of the Civic Party, I support the original motion. But then the Civic Party, in relation to incentivizing more subsidies to introduce a suitable international curriculum, more studies should be taken. And Ms. Starry LEE should also be telling us whether there is a typo in the point on the motion about increasing subsidized top-up places for the second year in universities. The top-up places mostly are in the third year in university. So, Ms. Starry LEE, please clarify on that point. And Mr. Kin-yuen has deleted that point altogether. But I must say that the Civic Party supports increasing the number of subsidized top-up places for the third year in universities. I have 4 points in my amendments. That is providing or achieve full implementation of free kinder education. In 1718, there was a free education kindergarten education implemented, but that was, but only half-day school got full subsidies. For whole-day and long-whole-day kindergartens, different subsidies are dispersed. But the secretary said that since the dual income families have more better financial means, so but then people who work, but for dual income families, they are, sometimes they are forced to work. It doesn't mean that they are better financially. So I hope that the government should not be half-hearted in implementing free KG education. And then I also asked for implementing small class teaching in full. If I remember correctly, Audrey Yu, the founder of a civic party, has been striving for that all along. But it seems that, this is nowhere to be seen yet. In fact, in the past 2 years, there has been a drop in the primary school enrollment number. So the government should take hold of this opportunity to implement small class teaching. The government should not be cutting the number of students, teachers and the classes. And teachers should not be asked to work in an unstable environment, because ultimately it will be the students who will suffer. There should be long-term planning made available to them. And Civic Party believes that small class teaching can help in addressing the problem of oversupply of teachers, and the pressure on the teachers can also be lessened. We should also help students on long debt in repaying the interest for their debt. I believe that the secretary has heard about this request for a long time, and I believe that many assistants in our office are on student long debt. We are glad that these graduates join our office in the political arena, but very often they are on debt as much as $100,000. According to a study, 29.8% said that they will have a loan of $15,000 on graduation. 25% said that they have a loan of $50,000 to $110,000. And 30% said that they are on a loan of $110,000. And 15% said that they are on a loan of $200,000 to $320,000, and 23.9% said they have to spend 14 years or so to repay all their debts. So it's very staggering. And 28.8% said the repayment period is 10 to 13 years. So this means that these those who are in their 20s, early 20s, and not experience difficulties in finding a career. Well, they are on a monthly salary of $14,000, and they are on a loan of hundreds of thousands of dollars. When they can they repay all the debt? So the Civic Party hopes that the government can assist students on debt loan in repaying the interest for the debt, so as to alleviate the pressure on them. We're not asking you to pay to help them repay the principal. Of course, we also ask for the government to formulate measures to support NCS students. The government has been implementing measures, but the actual results are far from desirable. Many capable NCS students cannot enroll in universities because their Chinese proficiency is subpar, and very often because they experience difficulties in learning Chinese at the early stage, and they couldn't get very good education. We hope that the government can implement comprehensive and regular measures to alleviate the pressure on these students. There has been a large surplus in the budget in the past decade, but the government has not been maximizing the use of the surplus in coming up with long-term education policies. The Civic Party believes the government should increase the recurring expenditure in education to the level as that required by OECD. It should implement good education measures to mitigate the pressure and burden on school, on parents, teachers, and students. If the government has the determination on building an artificial island in in implementing education policies, and that we will be grateful to the government. So I so speak.
Secretary for Education. Mr. President, I thank Ms. Starry LEE for moving this motion on implementing diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. A number of members have moved amendments to the motion. Education has always been an issue close to the heart of members. Now, from the remarks of the nine members just now, we understand that members are really very concerned about education in Hong Kong. And members also spoke from different perspectives on the issues facing the education sector and the phenomena, and they have given their views. The Education Bureau shares the same view. We'd like to provide quality education to our young people to help them grow and contribute to society. Let me first explain the government's policy and measures on today's motion. It is the long-standing education objective for the government to provide diversified and quality education for students. We continue to enhance the curricula of secondary and primary schools, and we have continued to put in resources to train teachers to improve their quality. In recent years, we have launched the life-wide learning and STEM education to aspire students to be innovative and to help them cultivate diversified interests and aptitude for them to have a whole person development and to have ability as well as integrity. We place equal emphasis to the five domains of education, and with diversified school education, we can take care of the needs of different students so that they can be equipped with the necessary skills, attitude, and knowledge to facilitate whole person education. And we also have life-wide learning, and with diversified strategy, we can help them broaden their horizons. Different jurisdictions or regions have different education systems, their curricula, teaching assessment systems are based on the factors relating to their own education development, social, culture, economic, and geographical factors. We attach importance to the bilingualism and trilingualism. We encourage students to learn more about Chinese history and Chinese culture. This is exactly in the light of the needs of Hong Kong. And to tie in with a global trend of education, we also, at appropriate times, enhance our curricula, including the promotion of STEM education. And in fact, Hong Kong students have excelled in different areas, and they have also made huge achievements in international competitions. The local education and curriculum does not fare in any way worse than other countries. Apart from local curriculum with characteristics at the policy level, our education system also provides diversified development to cater for the needs of different student groups. We offer choices for students and parents, and we have private schools and direct subsidy schools offering non-local curriculum for parents who wish to have their children take the courses. Like many other countries, regions in Asia, our education system has always been criticized as putting too much pressure on our young people. We must understand and discuss this issue. In the development of the process of a youth, they need to learn how to face and deal with different pressures, such as education, studying abroad, and interpersonal relationships, and we must help them cultivate positive attitude. And because this is part of life, we must counsel students to face pressure, not to run away from it. Some people may easily blame education system or open or public examination for the students' pressure. But I believe that studying is part of the life of a student, and over-drilling, of course, is not good. It should be changed. But at the same time, we must help tackle the source of the problem and help students learn how to alleviate pressure and face the challenges in a positive manner. And we must also help them equip themselves with a stamina and resilience. We must therefore emphasize core value education for them to meet the challenges in life. We don't believe that international school or or foreign or public examinations will be free of pressure. With the implementation of the NSS academic structure, the Hong Kong DSE has replaced the two public examinations in the past. We have reduced the number of examinations a student has to go through. We have also revised the guidelines on homework and tests to avoid over-drilling and mechanical drilling so that there is room for students to cultivate their interests and their aspirations. The response from the academic sector is positive. Mr. President, we strive to provide diversified and quality education to our students. We continue to upgrade our curriculum and enhance our teaching quality. I'll be happy to take views from members and I'll give a consolidated response afterwards.
Mr. Leung Yu-chong. President, the Secretary said just now that he keeps improving our education system and curriculum to encourage creativity and innovation in our students. Unfortunately, parents and our students view that we focus on spoon feeding and we do not focus on developing critical thinking and innovation, and our students have to face competition. As a result, they lose motivation in learning and they feel under pressure. We've seen a spate of suicides among students. If you say that that had nothing to do with our education system, I don't think that is convincing. And therefore, I agree entirely with Mr. Yip Kin-yuen. In his amendment, he said that we should review and improve the curriculum of public sector schools in Hong Kong. We should also reform our education system so that young people will not be just trained to cope with public education for a secondary tertiary place, thinking that that is the only way out. We have visited Germany to see the education system, and we feel that in Germany, they would nurture motivation of learning, and they have a career and academic streams of education running in parallel. They have multiple paths so the students can choose whether they want to attend university or to vocational training school. And the two are running in parallel depending on the interests of the students concerned. The focus is whether the government can do its very best to ensure that we have a level playing field for everyone. Many families cannot afford expensive education. In 2017, the population of poor students reached 170,000, which is 17.5%, and it goes to show the intergenerational poverty is very serious. Yes, diversity in education is important, but without financial support, if we expect parents and students to shoulder all the costs in learning, that is too great a pressure for them. We should not allow students to be deprived of opportunities because of a lack of means. And therefore, the education system should provide more financial support for students so that they will not lose out. While we promote diversification in education, we should provide allowances and support for students so that they can have access to equal education opportunities, regardless of their means. We should have more whole-day and long whole-day KG places with full subvention to lower the financial burden on needy families. And we should pay the examination fees of needy students so that their families do not have to face the heavy financial burden. And we should also relax the criteria for giving school fee subsidy. The threshold in means and income testing should be lowered, and perhaps student loans should be provided interest-free so that students will not graduate from universities already heavily indebted. And I like to turn to students with special education needs. Our SEN education is very limited, if I don't call it a failure. Take Taiwan as an example. They have a comprehensive law to provide comprehensive barrier-free education for SEN students, whether it be funding and teacher qualifications. There are statutory requirements. And SEN students are given full support, and their administration has taken the initiative to reform their system so that SEN students can be more easily integrate into their mainstream education. In Hong Kong, we have been talking about the needs of SEN students for more than a decade. Yes, the administration has improved in certain areas, taking on board views of the public. I don't have enough time to elaborate on this, but I hope the administration can give SEN students more support so that they will not lose out because of a lack of means or lack of support. As far as SEN students are concerned, there should be more physical and mental assessment centers. Currently, they rely on students, teachers who are after not experts in identifying SEN. And as for sign and the dual system of sign and verbal learning, and that is bilingualism, there are only 0.7% deaf students that can make their way to university education, not because of their capability. Rather, it is because in primary and secondary schooling, they do not enjoy equal opportunities compared with their able-bodied counterparts. So their chance of making to university is reduced. The administration should expeditiously improve our current mode of operation. And then you should really implement sign bilingualism so that this group of students would not be deprived of equal opportunities in education. And I don't want to see any more suicide cases among students. Thank you. Dr. Priscilla Lau. Thank you, President. The motion moved by Ms. Starry LEE is implementing diversified education to alleviate the pressure on students and parents. I don't think anyone will vote against this motion in this council. But what is meant by diversified education? Is diversification a panacea to the whole issue? Now, we have different types of schools, public sector, private sector schools, international schools, and DSS schools, and also schools for the gifted and also activity-oriented schools. And as said in the motion, we should expand the scope of STEM, meaning science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. We agree that there should be diversification in the content and system of our education. The issue I want to raise is, however, with diversification, can we address the problems faced by students nowadays? On the whole, I agree with the six suggestions in the motion, but I think we've missed out one important thing. We do not just need to educate parents, but teachers as well. And also people who develop the examination papers. We have to educate the Hong Kong Authority for Examination and Assessment. Why do I say so? Both of my sons studied in public mainstream schools. I was eligible for education allowance. Many of my colleagues send their children to overseas schools, but I deliberately placed my two sons in a public sector school so that they had to attend TSA. And then in primary and secondary schools, they had to be examined in visual arts. Well, my son really loved arts, however, because the passing rate was only 50% in visual arts, he now hates arts. Why should we talk about examination? This man said to embrace examination, no way. Well, recently I attended a dinner with the Hong Kong AEE. I rarely went to their receptions. Now, I like to talk about liberal studies and also TSA. Kin-yuen spent a large part of his speech on TSA, and many members here disagree with implementing TSA at P3 because we should not have too much drilling. TSA itself is not a sin. My two sons were the first and second cohorts that had to take TSA. However, now students have to be drilled. And what's wrong with liberal studies? After much now we have TS liberal studies. Now for Chinese, English, and physics, and so forth, liberal studies have to take LS examination. There must be compulsory questions. Why must it be a compulsory subject? Because teachers and schools are saying that if this is not a compulsory study, there won't be enough students to maintain the status quo. So they will insist on examination and testing in LS. So there will be both compulsory and optional questions. I don't mind having compulsory questions in some examination subjects. Well, but must LS and also visual arts have compulsory questions? Well, they want to preserve this so that we can have more jobs for LS students. So why didn't Yip Kin-yuen talk about LS? Why did he only talk about TSA? Well, I have got perhaps it is because of the PTU he represents here. Why has he refrained from criticizing liberal studies? Because many LS teachers are of the view that if there are no compulsory questions in LS examination, they would lose their importance. I've discussed with the Hong Kong EAA, and I said, I'm not asking you to abolish the subject. I'm only asking you not to set compulsory questions. Now, my two sons did very well in LS because we have two professors. They have two professors at home. Many of them go to other students go to tutorial schools. There are tutors, and they can tip what questions will be set in the next examination. So some students are doing very well in LS. It is not an elective subject, and you have to answer compulsory students. How can you encourage students to think out of the box? Well, even those who set examination papers may not be able to think out of the box. And the only stakeholders you consult are the teachers who teach LS. Have you ever asked students, given the choice, will they choose subjects or areas that they prefer more? And what about parents and also employers? Do they feel that students who have taken LS are more competitive? Why should we deprive of the students' right to choice? Now, for a science stream student, he has to spend a lot of time to study LS because it is a compulsory subject, a core subject. So we have to educate
teachers and parents and people who set examination papers and secretary, you yourself and your team should also change your mindset. If we do not change the system, we will then have let down a whole generation of students. I'm of the view that our education system must be changed at once. We should not focus on examinations.
Dr. Smith Quad, thank you. I'd like to thank Ms. Starry LEE for moving this important motion. And in her speech, she explained why she wanted to introduce more or a suitable portion of international curriculum to give more choices to parents and students. Many parents and students indicated that they are under great stress, and it's just they are unhappy. They have little motivation to learn. So for many middle-class families, by the time their children reach secondary school, they would send their children overseas or enroll in IB programs. So whether you like it or not, there is a demand for IB programs in Hong Kong because they provide an alternative option to create a happier environment for students. President, I want to focus on point 2 of Ms. Starry LEE's motion, that is expanding the scope of STEM to include elements such as arts and artificial intelligence and allocating additional resources to schools for training teachers and supporting schools in promoting the relevant education. As I have said before, technology helps create the future. The future will be technology-oriented. I have much concern on whether our children will be able to compete in the future. Everyone is talking about STEAM education or STEM plus arts, while others are making it compulsory. It is still optional in Hong Kong. Korea has already included coding education in preschool education, but we are yet to consider anything like that. Universities have been thinking about nurturing talent, and students have to pick up knowledge from different principals, and in this regard, Hong Kong is falling very, very far behind. We want our students to have the motivation to learn. So long as they have the motivation, they would learn proactively, and you don't have to force them to learn by rote. If we adopt STEAM education, we can help students find their interests so that they can become happy learners and easy learners. Even for schools with STEM or STEAM education, their focus is still on coding. DDB should enhance the measure. They have not thought about integrating STEM in other subjects. Some publishers have merged coding education with other subjects, so this is something the education and they should think about STEAM for English, STEAM for Chinese, STEAM for history, etc. By combining STEAM with other subjects, you can increase the students' motivation to learn. And the sector publishers should be encouraged to work with universities to come up with STEAM activities or programs. And this can further promote STEAM education in Hong Kong. Currently, there is a lack of teaching kids. And the second issue is the promotion of AI. I often visit schools. Recently, I attended a robotics competition between Hong Kong, Macau, and Guangzhou. It has been held for more than 10 years. In the past, Hong Kong students were outstanding, but now they always lose out. And robotics is an interesting part of STEAM education. And in one of the debates, the secretary said, you asked whether AI would become mainstream in the future and whether we should put our focus on AI. Knowledge is about acquisition and application. Everyone has an imagination, and certain knowledge might actually hinder imagination. So the acquisition of knowledge should be active, and it is a lifelong process. The education system should motivate students to learn, innovate, and make decisions. So the focus should be on capability, but not on exams. So we should promote the different abilities for students. The EDB should focus on tools to convey knowledge, and this would help students acquire new knowledge. AI is not just a subject. It is a discipline. It is about how we can promote lifelong learning. And nowadays, supercomputers and big data analysis can be used and for mechanical tasks such as exams or rote learning, machines will do a much better job than human beings. So our students should not be examination machines. This is something that should be done by robots. Many jobs in the future will be replaced by AI. So if we do not train our students to do something, something machines cannot, they would be eliminated. So this should be made compulsory. So apart from Chinese, English, and math, STEAM and AI should be made compulsory as well. I don't see why these are not more important than liberal studies. Thank you. Mr. Ma Fung Kwok. Thank you.